Materials supplied by Microsoft Corporation may be used for internal review, analysis, or research only. Any editing, reproduction, publication, rebroadcast, public showing, internet, or public display is forbidden and may violate copyright law.
So my name is Krista Savori, and I'm the manager and a researcher in the Quantum Architectures and Computation Group, Quark, here at Microsoft Research in Redmond. And today I have the privilege of welcoming three very distinguished scientists and computer scientists that range from computer science to physics, who work with us on quantum computing, on the algorithms and also on the devices. So quantum algorithms take advantage of methods founded on the laws of quantum physics. And of course, we know that they promise computational speedups over classical methods in some cases. For example, Shor's algorithm in cryptographic protocols such as RSA, and in also other cases as well. So most of these quantum algorithms actually draw on just a small number of techniques. Amplitude amplification, as used in Grover's algorithm, which gives a quadratic speedup. We have quantum annealing, which we'll hear about in the last talk today. And then also quantum phase estimation, which is used in Shor's algorithm and other number theory type algorithms. And these offer fast solutions to a variety of problems in fields such as number theory, database search, chemistry, and physics. So here at Microsoft, we have two groups that study quantum computation. So we have the Quark group here in Redmond, and we focus on quantum algorithms and then how to implement these algorithms, studying things starting from the high-level programming languages, how you would program the quantum computer, and then translate the quantum algorithm all the way down to the device specification. And so, of course, there's many intricacies along this tool chain that we must develop and that, you know, that are very special to the quantum domain. So this gives a very rich and interesting set of problems for us to work on. Our sister group down in Santa Barbara is Station Q, Microsoft Station Q. And there they focus on topological quantum computing. It's a group of theoretical physicists who are trying to develop a more scalable type of quantum device. And this relies on the properties of physical hardware for error correction, as opposed to massive software used for the error correction in more conventional computing quantum computing systems. So the system is naturally then protected from noise. So the Majorana fermion is the particle at the heart of these topological quantum computing proposals. And we've been really excited in the last year because this Majorana fermion, this Majorana zero mode, was elusive for almost a century. Until a breakthrough last year when one of our collaborators, Leo Cohenhoven at Delft, actually saw the statistics and saw this Majorana quasi-particle. So this excitement has really stimulated scientists to seek breakthroughs in quantum algorithms and also devices. So today we're going to begin by hearing about what quantum computers are good for. So what can quantum computers do, or what do we think they'll be able to do, and what can they not do? So we're going to hear from Scott Aronson about quantum algorithms and their capacity. And then we're going to hear about how quantum devices are being built. And in particular, we'll hear about the tremendous progress in realizing topological qubits from Charlie Marcus, who's one of our university partners who works on, is an experimental physicist and works on actually building these devices. And then finally, we're going to conclude our session by hearing about recent advances in understanding existing quantum devices. In particular, we'll hear from Matthias Troyer, who's also one of our collaborators, who's worked on understanding the D-Wave device. This D-Wave is a quantum computer company in Vancouver, Canada, and there's been a lot of skepticism in the field since D-Wave started about 10-ish years ago on whether or not it's actually a quantum device. Matthias Troyer and his colleagues have done an extensive study taking really the first key steps towards understanding what this device is capable of and whether or not it is quantum. So that's how we'll wrap up our session, and then we'll have some Q&A at the end of the session. So we're really moving from the algorithms to the devices to something that exists today, so it should be very exciting. So I first want to introduce our first speaker, Scott Aronson, who's the TIBCO Career Development Associate Professor of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science at MIT. Scott's research focuses on the capabilities and limits of quantum computers and computational complexity theory more generally. Besides his widely read blog, which is really a great read, you should all read it regularly, he's written a popular book, Quantum Computing Since Democritus, and articles about quantum computing for Scientific American as well as the New York Times. He's received the National Science Foundation's Alan T. Waterman Award, as well as MIT's Junior Bose Award for Excellence in Teaching. So please welcome Scott, who's going to speak to us about quantum algorithms and complexity.
Okay, so thanks so much for inviting me. So Krista actually asked me to speak about both quantum algorithms and quantum money in 25 minutes. So I decided to speak about something even broader, which is quantum mechanics. What is it good for? So, there's a few obvious things that it's good for. First of all, the original application, quantum mechanics, keeps all the atoms in the universe from instantly disintegrating. This is a useful application. It allows the transistor, and the laser to work. Because the transistor is already a quantum device. You could say that in some sense, all of our computers are already quantum computers. Not really. But quantum mechanics was sort of already central to the information revolution. Of course, we would like to sort of exploit it in even more direct ways, or at a higher level. Also, quantum mechanics helps to sell all sorts of new age books and films, the Dancing Wu-Li Masters and that kind of thing. You're here, I suppose, to hear about quantum computing. So when I did a Google image search for quantum computer, this was one of the first things that came up. That's apparently what they look like. As should become clear from this talk, I'm a theorist, I'm not an engineer. I didn't try a Bing search, by the way, but maybe that would show me what they really look like. So what is a quantum computer? Well, to answer that question, we first have to say, what is quantum mechanics? And, quantum mechanics has this reputation for being, complicated and hard. But, the secret is just started to spill out over the last couple decades is that actually quantum mechanics is unbelievably simple once you take the physics out of it. So here's a way to explain what is quantum mechanics that hopefully will make more sense to people here. So imagine that we have this a stack. At the bottom level, our hardware layer is pure mathematics. Okay, that's not going to change anytime soon. The application layer, or the physical theories that govern various aspects of the world, particles and fields. So electromagnetism, the nuclear forces, gravity. But then in between the hardware layer and the application layer, as people here presumably know, we need an OS layer. In particular, we need sort of a theory that tells us how should we describe the state of a system, in cases where we have incomplete knowledge of it. That might not sound like a physics question at all, right? It sort of isn't, right? You'd say, well, it's obvious that we should use probabilities. This is our language for uncertainty, right? So, in particular, if we're not sure what state a system is in, we describe it with this vector of non-negative real numbers, which have to add up to one, and which we call probabilities. And they obey all sorts of rules that we understand. If you do something to the system, then this vector gets multiplied by what's called a Markov matrix or a stochastic matrix. You get a new probability vector. So basically what quantum mechanics is it's an OS upgrade. Like most OS upgrades, it breaks some things. You know, I just tried Windows 8 the other day, sorry. But you know, you can see that the gravity application has not quite been ported to this particular OS. Okay, but quantum mechanics is sort of a level below any of these specific physical theories. Okay, and it says that actually we have to change the entire language with which we talk about uncertainty. Okay, now instead of a vector of non-negative real numbers, we need a vector of complex numbers. Okay, why complex numbers? Well, you know, God prefers them. Okay, they're more elegant. Okay, so and now you know the sum of the squared absolute values of these complex numbers has to be one. And there's a rule: when you look at the system, then these complex numbers, which are called amplitudes, get converted into probabilities. Okay, and the rule is the probability of seeing, say, a particular outcome I is going to be the squared absolute value of the amplitude of outcome I. Okay, so you still, at the end of the day, get probabilities, but the means of calculating probabilities is completely different than it was in the classical world. Particularly, you know, to find the probability of something, you first need to get its amplitude. And to get the amplitude of something, you have to add up, you know, a contribution or a complex number from each possible way that the thing could have happened. Okay? And so the result of that is that if something can happen one way with a positive amplitude and another way, say, with a negative amplitude, then those two amplitudes can cancel each other out, the result being that the thing never happens at all. Okay, that's called quantum interference. You know, and any time anyone tells you anything about the weirdness of the quantum world, you know, whether it's about a cat that's alive and dead, or it's about, you know, entangled particles, or it's about tunneling, doesn't matter what it is, you know, either it's wrong or else it ultimately has an explanation in terms of this interference of quantum, of positive and negative amplitudes. This is sort of the one trick that gets repeated over and over. So, you know, in particular, what is a quantum computer? It's just a computer that would exploit this trick of quantum interference, sort of on a very massive scale. So you would try to arrange a computation in such a way that sort of for each wrong answer, you know, some of the paths leading to it have positive amplitudes, others have negative amplitudes, and so they interfere destructively and cancel each other out. Okay, whereas the paths that lead to a right answer should all be in phase with one another. Like they should either all be positive or all be negative. Okay, and if you can arrange that, then when you measure, you know, indeed a right answer will be observed with high probability. Okay, but you know, the only advantage of quantum mechanics, the only thing that it gives you over just a classical computer with a random number generator, is that these amplitudes, unlike probabilities, can interfere with each other. Okay, they can be, you know, either positive or negative, and so they can cancel. Okay, and so that's really kind of a specialized ability, and that's the reason why when physicists like Richard Feynman and David Deutsch first proposed the idea of quantum computing in the early 1980s, you know, it wasn't obvious that there was that much you could do with it. Well, you know, there was one thing that it was fairly obvious that you could do, namely you could simulate quantum physics. Okay, you know, and actually, I think if we ever get practical quantum computers, you know, that's likely to be the most important real application of them, because, you know, this is just what a quantum computer does in its sleep, right? That's what it's sort of really designed for, right? And, you know, and that's actually a huge application area, you know, with applications to chemistry, to protein folding, to maybe pharmaceuticals design, maybe, you know, high energy physics, understanding high temperature superconductivity. Okay, there's all sorts of things that a general purpose quantum simulator could be useful for. You know, so I think that remains sort of the, you know, the preeminent, you know, application of quantum computing, even though it's sort of so obvious that we, you know, we often don't even talk about it. But what really got people excited about this field was the discovery that this trick of quantum interference can sometimes be exploited to, you know, even to solve sort of purely classical problems faster than a classical computer could solve them or is known to be able to solve them. Okay, and so, you know, if you read almost any popular article about the subject, right, it'll say, well, yeah, unlike a classical computer, a quantum computer works by just trying all the possible solutions in parallel and, you know, instantly picking the best one, right? And, you know, that kind of sounds too good to be true, and it is. Okay, that's not how it works. You know, and the problem is that, you know, at some point you've got to measure your computer and get an answer out, right? And if you had just tried every possible answer in quantum superposition, which indeed you can do, then when you measure, you're just going to get out a random answer. Okay, and of course, if you had just wanted a random answer, you could have picked one yourself, right? No need for this giant lab full of dilution refrigerators and, you know, and all this stuff. Okay, so you know, once again, you know, the only hope for getting a speed up quantum mechanically rests on this phenomenon of interference. Okay, so let's see, what is interference good for? What is it known to be good for? So the main quantum algorithms known, you know, as Krista said, fall into a relatively small number of families. So the most famous ones are Shor's algorithm for quickly factoring, you know, enormous numbers, which is a problem of interest, you know, not only to number theorists, but to, you know, various three-letter agencies, for example, since, you know, most of the cryptography that we use for, you know, sending our credit card numbers with SSL and so forth, you know, depends on the assumption that, you know, either factoring is hard or discrete logarithm is hard or elliptic curve problems are hard. Okay, all of these things could be solved efficiently in polynomial time if we had a quantum computer. Okay, and that was Shor's big discovery from almost 20 years ago. And generally these types of algorithms, which rely on what's called the quantum Fourier transform, are useful for, you know, a bunch of different things, all of which somehow involve group theory or algebra or number theory. So they have some sort of, in fact, abelian group structure underneath them that can be exploited by doing like a quantum Fourier transform, which is sort of like a gigantic change of basis, you know, and again, ultimately relying on this interference effect. Okay, so then, you know, there's quantum simulation, which I already mentioned, which is sort of the obvious application. And then, you know, what about for sort of a generic problem? You know, you have like a bunch of possible solutions, you know, you're just looking for a good one. And there may not be any, you know, any elegant group structure underlying the problem. Well, sort of generically, for just searching a list of n possibilities, we know of Grover's algorithm, which gives you a quadratic speed up, okay, which lets you solve that kind of problem in on the order of square root of n steps. Okay, so it's not an exponential speed up, but, you know, it's a quadratic one. So like instead of 2^1,000th steps for solving some NP complete problem, for example, you might merely need 2^500 steps. Okay, so, you know, but on the other hand, it's also known that if you don't exploit sort of the structure of the problem in any deeper way, if you just think of it as like a giant abstract haystack in which you're looking for a needle, then you actually, then Grover's algorithm is optimal. You have to actually make at least, you know, square root of n steps, even with a quantum computer, to find the thing you're looking for with high probability. Okay, Grover's algorithm has been generalized to, you know, all sorts of other problems. For example, for evaluating game trees, for like deciding which player, you know, has a win from a given chess position, you could also get a quadratic speed up for that. Okay, for various other things like finding collisions in a long list of numbers, you know, like attack, like breaking collision-resistant hash functions, you could get a smaller speed up over classical, actually an n^2/3 power speed up. Okay, but again, no better than that. Okay, and then, you know, what about if you do exploit the structure? You know, if you're, so you know, factoring is great, but it's neither known nor believed to be NP complete, right? And so, you know, the real holy grail, of course, would be a fast quantum algorithm to solve the NP complete problems, okay? This is not known to exist. That's an important point, okay? But classically, of course, you know, we don't do brute force when we're confronted with an NP-complete problem. We use various heuristics, like simulated annealing, like taboo search, We do all sorts of clever sort of local search tricks. And so you could say, well, what if you souped up, local search with quantum effects? Then what would happen? Okay, and so then this leads to the quantum adiabatic algorithm proposed by Ed Farhi and his colleagues about 14 years ago. And this is sort of a quantum enhanced, it's sort of like simulated annealing, but enhanced by quantum tunneling effects. And although this algorithm has been studied for more than a decade now, we still don't really understand it. We don't really know sort of how much of a speed up, if any, it will give us on practical problems, if we have a quantum computer. We know that there are theoretical examples that you can build where this adiabatic algorithm will actually reach a global minimum exponentially faster than simulated annealing will. Okay, but then there are other theoretical examples you can build where both the adiabatic algorithm and simulated annealing will get stuck in local optima, and both of them will take exponential time to get out of it and get to the global optimum. Okay, and there's yet other examples you can build where simulated annealing will do exponentially better than the adiabatic algorithm. Okay, so what we'd really like to know is how well will it do in practice? And for that question, it would really help if we had a quantum computer to test it out on, right? And so, as Krista also mentioned, there is a company, which has, spent $150 million so far, roughly, sort of on the bet that, the adiabatic algorithm, and in fact, a much noisier, sort of less quantumly coherent version of the adiabatic algorithm called quantum annealing, will be able to get speed ups for practical problems. Okay, this is not at all, established. So, you could say, it's wonderful that they're sort of, spending all of this for fundamental science, for something where we really, really don't know if there's any speed up to be had by this route. And so, we're very lucky that Matthias is going to tell us later in this session about, the results of his group's experiments to figure out exactly what their current devices are doing. Okay, and then there are other quantum algorithms proposed, learning properties of a linear system with some possible machine learning applications, and several other things. Okay, where does quantum computing sort of fit into the hierarchy of complexity theory that many of you might have seen as undergraduates? So, we have P and NP, which, we famously don't know if they're equal. Well, all right, fine. We know they're not equal. We can't prove it. And then there's these NP complete problems. And now there's the quantum version of P is called BQP. It stands for bounded error quantum polynomial time. This is the class of problems that are efficiently solvable by a quantum computer. And so this is sort of the quantum generalization of the class P. Okay, this is sort of, as far as we know, this is the class of efficiently solvable problems, under the actual laws of physics, rather than what we might have thought, sitting in our armchairs, would have been the laws of physics. Okay, and so, as you can see, it looks like it slightly generalizes P. At the least, it lets us do this factoring and discrete log problems, which, are not known to be in P. Where we base the security of all our e-commerce on the belief that they're not in P. Okay, but we don't think BQP extends all the way to, encompass the NP complete problems. Of course, we can't prove that. We can't even prove that classical computers, can't efficiently solve the NP complete problems. That's P versus NP. Okay, but we certainly don't know how to do it in BQP. There are some other problems in NP that we could try to design quantum algorithms for, that we don't have them for yet, or like graph isomorphism, which are also, seem to have some structure that prevents them from being NP complete. And conversely, we don't know whether BQP is contained in NP. So this means that there could be problems where a quantum computer can find the correct answer in polynomial time, but it really has no proof of that answer that it can give to a classical skeptic. Okay, so factoring, of course, if a quantum computer factors a giant number, you don't have to believe anything about how the computer was working. You can just check the factors for yourself. Okay, but for a quantum simulation, right, let's say it tells you, you know, okay, I ran this simulated, you know, this quantum process, and, you know, the answer is 42, right? You know, how do I know that that's the right answer? Well, then, you know, I may have to believe that the computer was working correctly. Okay, so, and then all of this, you know, NP and BQP can all be simulated in by a classical computer with a polynomial amount of memory, so in the class P space. So in particular, this tells us that quantum computers can only ever get an exponential speed up over classical computers, right? They'll never get more than that. So in particular, quantum computers don't affect the theory of computability at all. Okay, they don't like change, you know, they're not going to let us solve the halting problem or anything like that. Okay, but for some special problems, they could give, you know, up to an exponential speed up. You know, now you could ask, how good is the evidence, really, that BQP is larger than P? You know, certainly it contains P, but, you know, does it strictly contain it? Well, you know, if you think that factoring is not in P, then, you know, certainly you have to believe that BQP is bigger, because that does contain factoring. Okay, if you want sort of stronger evidence than that, so in work a few years ago, my student Alex Arkhipov and I observed that... If a quantum computer could solve sampling problems, if it could sample from every probability distribution that sort of a classical computer could feasibly sample from, then this would have very drastic consequences for complexity theory. Particularly, an exact sampling algorithm quantum sampling algorithm running on a classical computer would mean that the polynomial hierarchy would collapse the third level. Which, if you don't know what that means, yeah, it's bad. Okay, we think even an approximate sampling algorithm would have the same consequence. So the evidence, I think, is pretty strong that quantum computers, you know, if you can implement them, do give you at least some advantage for some problems, you know, over a classical computer. Okay, but, you know, but on the other hand, as we've seen, the advantages are, you know, contrary to what many of the popular articles, you know, and try to portray it, you know, they are rather specialized in nature as far as we can tell today. Okay, so, you know, you might say, okay, so then what about, can we put quantum mechanics to work for things, you know, other than just solving computational problems faster? Maybe if we look more broadly, then we'll find more useful things that we can do. So one sort of very natural idea is, you know, using quantum mechanics for random number generation, right? You could, you know, generate high quality random numbers. In fact, you know, what? Oh, good, good. Here's an example of a quantum random number generator, apparently. Thank you. Yeah, it even says quantum random number generator right on it. Okay, so it's, you know, these are, you know, the highest quality random numbers that you could ever hope for, right? But now, you know, a question arises, which is, you know, why should you really trust that the number, whatever numbers come out of that little literal black box are actually random, right? I mean, yeah, sure, let's say, you know, let's assume we believe quantum mechanics. You know, even then, why should we assume that the device was engineered correctly, that it's calibrated correctly? Okay, and, you know, these seem like unanswerable questions. So it's very amazing that just within the last few years, work by Kolbeck, Peronio et al., Vazirani and Vidic, we actually have a quite good answer to this question, which is that, well, let's say that we had two such boxes, okay, and let's say that they were entangled with each other. And let's say that we could use them to violate a Bell inequality, which I'll tell you what that is. Okay, then it turns out that one can prove that either the outputs of these boxes sort of have to have some true entropy in them, some true randomness, which we could then sort of purify into higher quality random numbers, or else these two devices must have been conspiring with each other using faster than light communication in order to sort of bias the numbers. Okay, and that we really don't believe that they're doing. So what is this Bell inequality? So we have two players, Alice and Bill, and so they get, you know, these, it's just a certain game where they get these random bits, call them X and Y respectively, which are, you know, independent of each other, and Alice wants to output a bit A, and Bill wants to output a bit B, such that the XOR of A and B equals the AND of X and Y. Why do they want to do this? I don't know. Okay, but they can do it better if they share quantum entanglement than if they don't. And that's the point. Okay, so it's an easy exercise that, you know, if they can't, they can agree on a strategy in advance, but then they can't talk to each other after they get X and Y, the best that they could ever do is just always output zero, let's say. And then they'll win this game with 3/4 probability. Okay, on the other hand, what Bell showed back in the 60s is that if they share an EPR pair, so an entangled quantum state like that one, then there is a strategy by which they could use the state to correlate their answers in such a way that they could win the game 85% of the time. Okay, so they're still not doing faster than light communication, right? That's still, you know, a no-no, right? But they're doing something that in a classical universe would have required faster than light communication. Okay, so that's the subtle point about the Bell inequality. And and the experiment has indeed been done, and indeed you can win this game 85% of the time. Okay, and the recent observation is that, you know, if you built like random number generators that allowed you to win this game 85% of the time, you could use that very fact to certify that the outputs really are random. Okay, so another place where you can do this kind of thing is for quantum cryptography. So this is another thing which, you know, is already commercially available. How much of a market there is for it is another question. You know, I don't know. But you can buy these devices that let you send encoded messages, you know, over, you know, encoded into the polarization states of photons, you know, which are sent down a fiber optic cable. And and the key property of quantum cryptography, which is an old idea from the 1980s, is that if an eavesdropper tries to eavesdrop on your channel, then the very fact that the eavesdropper is eavesdropping will change the quantum states of the photons and will therefore be detectable by the honest parties, by Alice and Bill. Okay, so once again, you could ask, suppose some company sells you a quantum cryptography device, why should you trust that it's actually secure? You know, and this was a major problem for the field. And, you know, we have very recent developments that tell us that by violating a Bell inequality in a suitable way, actually it is possible for a quantum cryptography device to prove to a skeptic that it's working correctly. Okay, and this is a long line of work, starting with Myers and Yao, and with a recent advance by Vazirani and Wittig. Okay, now, on the other hand, quantum cryptography does require special hardware. You know, you need a special quantum internet, you know, to send the qubits over. And, an existing public key cryptography, you know, let's face it, is pretty good. So many people have pointed out the irony that it might take quantum computers breaking our existing public key cryptography to create the market for quantum cryptography. Okay, so... All right. What else can we do? Well, one of my favorite ideas is quantum money. So these would be, these were proposed by Steven Wiesner, actually, a long time ago. And here, each bill would have some qubits on it. Okay, so there's a bit of a technological problem here, which some of you might see, which is that usually in the lab, qubits, can maintain their quantum coherence for a few microseconds, in the absolute best cases, a few seconds. A few minutes is the record. Okay, so this is money that would really, really burn a hole in your pocket, right? You better spend it fast. Okay, so there's a technological problem. Maybe for high frequency trading, it would be okay. Okay, so but we can ask. Okay, suppose that you could put quantum states on your money. What would that buy you, so to speak? So what you could do is that the bank would remember the quantum states on each bill. And so could verify them by measuring. But on the other hand, counterfeiters would be physically unable to copy bills. And the reason for that is this no cloning theorem that says that there is no physical procedure that will reliably copy an unknown quantum state. Okay, you have to choose a basis in which to measure the state. And if you choose the wrong one, then not only will you fail to make a copy, you'll even destroy the first copy that you had. Okay, so this leads to a scheme for physically uncounterfeitable money. The problem with it is that the only entity able to verify the bills as genuine is the bank that printed them. So it's like at this point you might as well just use a third party, like a credit card agency, right? So a major research problem in this field was, could you have quantum money that anyone can verify is legitimate, not only the bank that printed it, but which would still be hard to counterfeit. Okay, and if this is possible, then it certainly requires some computational assumptions in addition to the no cloning theorem, because, you know, if a counterfeiter had unlimited computation time, and if it also has a description of the verification procedure, well, then it can always just brute force it and just try every possible quantum state one by one until it finds one that works. Okay, but under some cryptographic assumptions, we actually now know how to do this. So the basic paradigm was proposed by Farhi et al., which is that you have a serial number for each bill, and then you have a classical digital signature of the serial number, and then you also have a quantum state depending on the serial number. Okay, and so Paul Cristiano and I just last year proposed sort of the first such scheme for publicly verifiable quantum money, where we can actually base its security on some sort of more or less standard cryptographic assumption. Okay, in this case involving multivariate polynomial cryptography. Okay, so we now have a scheme for sort of publicly verifiable quantum money, you know, that looks pretty secure. The main problem is just you need a way to prepare the states and keep them coherent, but that's a problem for the engineers. Okay, so the very last thing to mention is quantum copy protected software. You know, I've used this joke in many talks, but you know, here it seems singularly appropriate. Here you would have a quantum state that lets you compute some unknown function, but doesn't let you create more states with which the same function could be computed. This is easy to do if f is just a function that recognizes some secret password, right? You just have to store like a quantum fingerprint of that password, and then you can check it. Okay, so Paul Cristiano and I, in work in progress, have a proposed way to do this, to have quantumly copy protect sort of arbitrary functions. We don't know how to prove its security yet, except in a black box model. Okay, but this is another thing that you could do by sort of exploiting this no cloning theorem. So, conclusions. Quantum weirdness can indeed be put to work to do some very surprising things, you know, some of which are just flat out impossible in a classical world, like, you know, uncopyable money, others of which, like the fast factoring, are intractable in a classical world. Okay, how important will any of these applications be in real life? And how long will it take until the most dramatic ones, like quantum money and quantum computing, actually become practical? Well, you know, unfortunately, we don't know. Now, you know, in quantum computing research, I think, you know, if we're intellectually honest, we always have to ask for anything, right? Is there also a classical way to do this? You know, and if so, how do we know there isn't? How do we rule it out? Okay. People say, oh, you know, like, it's so hard to design quantum algorithms because people don't have intuition for it. I don't know if that's really true. You know, some of us actually have pretty good intuition now for how to design quantum algorithms. And often, ironically, the hardest part of writing your paper is to prove that there's no classical algorithm that does the same thing, you know, or that it's exponentially, you know, inefficient, right? Because now you have to, you know, prove an impossibility, okay, which is always harder. In my opinion, asking this sort of question about what can quantum mechanics do for us, you know, better than classical mechanics can do it, right? How do we prove the difference between the two and so forth, you know, has given us unprecedented insight into quantum mechanics itself. And for me personally, that's more than enough reason to continue studying this field. In fact, for me, I think the most important application of quantum computing, you know, is disproving the people who say that it's impossible. Okay, which, you know, look, the world just spent $11 billion to build this Large Hadron Collider, basically just to disprove the people who said that there's no Higgs boson. Okay, I think that it's worth a similar sum to disprove the people who say that quantum computing is impossible. Thank you.
Scott, for that very dynamic talk. Our next talk is actually going to try, you know, take steps towards addressing how practical, you know, when we might see some of these devices and proposals that Scott showed actually in practice. So our next speaker is Charlie Marcus, who's the Willem Kahn Rasmussen Professor and Director of the Center for Quantum Devices at the Niels Bohr Institute at the University of Copenhagen in Denmark. Charlie received his PhD from Harvard. He taught at Stanford from 92 to 2000, and then at Harvard from 2000 to 2012, where he also served as the director of the Harvard Center for Nanoscale Systems. So Charlie's research focuses on quantum coherence in electron devices and solid-state implementations of quantum information processing systems. Recent work includes experiments on spin control in semiconductor quantum dot systems, control of electronic states in nanowires, carbon nanotubes in graphene, development of hyperpolarized nanoparticles for medical imaging, interference effect in the fractional quantum Hall regime with the aim of detecting non-abelian particle statistics, and realization and control of Majorana fermions in semiconductor superconductor hybrid structures. Charlie is a fellow of the American Physical Society, recipient of the Newcomb Cleveland Prize for the AAAS, and the Presidential Early Career Award and the Sloan Fellowship. And Charlie is one of our university collaborators who works with us on building these topological qubits. So I'll turn it over to Charlie.
Thanks. Well, Scott took the physics out of the last talk. And as an experimentalist, I feel obliged to try to put it back in. I don't share with Scott the idea that quantum mechanics, with or without the physics, is an easy subject. And so I want to... The title that my talk, I think, was given, I don't remember whether I gave it or someone else made it up, but it was called How to Build a Quantum Computer. And I want to take the concluding slide of Scott's presentation and use that as my theme. And in fact, I would like to really have, in some ways, the talk be the experimentalist's counterpoint to the mathematical and computer science version that you just heard in the last talk, which is to really draw particular attention to some of these weird aspects. And I'll highlight three of them in this presentation. If I can make this thing click, maybe this is the first one that's... Let's see. Is that going to go? No, maybe I have to take this out and put it back in again. Or maybe I just have to stand over here and click it. No? I'll try that one more time, excuse me. Okay. So weirdness number one, which I think, regardless of your background, you know, if you've been awake at any point in the 20th or 21st century, you're aware of this one weirdness, which is that the kind of interference experiments that people routinely perform with waves, when you do them with things which are demonstrably particle-like, and I mean a particular thing by that, I mean when they impinge upon a screen and make a spot on the screen, that when you let a lot of them go through, you see a lot of the interference effects that you would associate with waves. And so this chestnut of it's a wave or a particle is so, you know, mundane and familiar at this point that I think that it hasn't been fully appreciated that what this means in practice is that measurement really isn't the right word. Because before that particle was measured as a spot on the screen, it wasn't anywhere. It didn't have a location. And so if you phrase this in an ensemble sense, that is, if you talk about the statistics of where they arrive, then I agree with Scott that you can think of this in terms of probabilities. But what's fundamentally lacking is the idea that if you let one particle go, just one, where does it go? Where does it land? And what Bohr taught us, and what we haven't come up with a better answer since, is you can't ask that question. That's a forbidden question. So if you're happy with that, then it's okay. You should be happy with everything else. But if you're not happy with the idea that the question of where did that particle go you know, you'd think as a physicist this would be a somewhat unsatisfying answer to say you can't ask that question. Feels a little, you know, schoolmarmish to say that that's a forbidden question. And yet, we must live with that as an answer. So how do we handle that mathematically? Well, in a way, the mystery of that whole fact disappears when you mathematicize it and you say, well, I understand that I can write a bit or a spin or the position of a switch on the wall as being on or off at the same time, and quantum mechanics allows us to write down superpositions of those states so that something can be on and off. It is the same as the previous experiment because you could say it went through the left slit and the right slit at the same time as the necessary condition for the interference to exist. But this is sort of the mathematicization of that phenomenon. And so when we begin to think about quantum computing and you start to think about the transistors inside of your chip, these billion transistors that are in our pockets or the multi-billions that are on our desktops, of having them all be in some kind of superposition all at the same time, it becomes a lot to think about. And it is not something which is, it doesn't reflect one's lack of knowledge of the state. It's not something in which you consider an ensemble because you didn't know what state it was in. It was in all of them until it was measured, or it was in some thing that we don't have a word for until it was measured. That brings us to weirdness number two, which is to some extent distinct, or you could say it's a reflection of weirdness number one, but I want to make it distinct because it's relevant for quantum computing, and that is this notion of entanglement. The idea that you can take two particles, let's take a mundane example of the ground state of a helium atom, the very helium that fills helium balloons, take one atom, take the two electrons away from it, and those two electrons will have a particular correlation. It's not the simplest thing in the world. I drew them here as one pointing up and one pointing down, like you learned in, you know, chemistry one. But if you stuck around for chemistry two, you were told that, in fact, it wasn't quite right that one was up and one was down. In fact, one was up and down, and minus down and up, because you didn't know which one was which, and that minus sign makes a lot of difference. Because up, down, plus down, up is a different state. So that minus sign that controls the relationship between those two gets this name S for singlet. But imagine if you took those two and separated them and you performed a measurement on one, you wouldn't know whether that was the up or the down, but the other one somehow would know. Now, the reason that you can't simply say, oh, yeah, well, that just reflects your ignorance of which one was which, and you found out, just like when you get to work and you say, oh, my God, I left my keys at home. It's not that they suddenly appeared at home. It's just that you found out that you didn't have them all along. You could say, is this that problem? You didn't know whether it was up, but then you found out. The other one was down. It knew all along. And the reason that that's not right, that would be the simple answer where you say, it's no problem. It just reflects our ignorance again. Is that there are a whole series of measurements, an infinite number of measurements, that you can perform on this object, and the other one will know to give a correlated answer. So you could ask, where was it keeping all of that information about if you ask me this, say this, if you ask me that, say that? And the answer is, it was nowhere. It didn't exist. The information, in some way, was transferred between one and the other when the measurement was performed in a way that doesn't allow messaging, but it's certainly more than nothing. And that transfer can occur acausally, faster than the speed of light. And if you don't like it, and that sounds wrong, or sounds like I'm deliberately hyping the weirdness of it, I'm not. It's a fact of nature that is very hard to believe. So hard to believe, you might simply just not believe it. You might just think, that's unbelievable, that I measured one and the other one on the other side of the galaxy suddenly became something because I measured this one. It's like voodoo. Sticking a pin, the other guy says, ouch. Even voodoo might happen at the speed of light, but this happens faster than the speed of light, and that's right. This version of voodoo is right. And we know it's right because there's a whole series of experiments dating back to the 1970s because it was so unbelievable that over and over and over again, these experiments were done and the experiments were verified. And as an experimentalist, at some point I start saying, this can't be right, I start saying, this is my problem, not physics's problem. And that's our situation. So to get back to this cat, you know, in the long quote, but I don't need to read you the quote. You know the quote about the cat and the cyanide and the, okay, and the cat is half alive and half dead. But it's, you know, and it was designed to illustrate the idea that this superposition notion really has some profound and maybe profoundly disturbing implications about the implications of this notion of measurement until you measure. Who looks in the box? Did you kill the cat when you looked in the box, et cetera? The question is a bit of a setup because, in fact, the conditions, as we'll talk about in a minute, to make this kind of multi-particle entangled system, if you don't mind my lowering, you know, the animal kingdom to that definition, is that it needs to be near absolute zero, and that would probably already kill the cat. So, but the interesting part of this problem is that a chip with billions of transistors on it, which, okay, it's not a cat, but you know, it's partway to a cat. It's many interacting particles whose state determines the states of other particles and whose overall performance can seem, you know, lifelike, is distinct from a cat in the sense that it's perfectly happy to operate at absolute zero. It really doesn't change its performance as the temperature goes down, 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 to the point where the quantum mechanical coherence of the system becomes longer and longer lived as the system gets cold. And so the idea of making something like this, a processor with billions of transistors, each one in some kind of state of being alive and dead at the same time, not only that, but each one's state determining the other one's state on the other side of the chip, acausally in time, is physically possible. In fact, it's the only theory of quantum mechanics. It's not controversial at all. There's nobody anywhere who says, well, that's not quite true. There's nobody anywhere who says that something of finite size that does this kind of thing can't be built. There are people who don't think it can scale, et cetera, and the time won't go on forever, and there's fundamental decoherence. But at the level of the conversations that we're having about these kinds of machines, this is not controversial stuff at all. And it's shocking that no one has even approached building it yet. It's physically possible, shockingly powerful, totally counterintuitive, and no one's made one. And that seems to me, and a lot of other experimentalists, enough. Whether we factor numbers, whether we solve protein folding. The fact is that there's a chapter of quantum mechanics that we don't know how to control, which is to make a machine that uses this entanglement. We don't know how to do it. And yet, it seems possible. The version of this that I play around with, I'm going to talk about two of them that are going on in my lab. And they are specific, and they're not necessarily the best things going, but they're the ones that I know about, so they're the ones that I can talk about. This one has to do with quantum dots and using the spin of an electron, which is the fact that an electron carries angular momentum, and it also carries one other thing that we'll get to later, which is statistics. It carries a fermion character. As a way of storing information. But for now, you can imagine it being that there's one extra variable inside of an electron besides the fact that it has mass and charge. It also has angular momentum, as if it were spinning. And the angular momentum can, when measured, take on one of two states, as if it were a binary element. And so a paper that appeared in 1998 that gave experimentalists our working orders, which was, it said, put one of these electrons in each box, and they were drawn to indicate that they have an angular momentum associated with it, the little vector of the spinning angular momentum. And then said, occasionally, with time control, touch the two electrons to each other. Because you remember the helium atom that I showed you, that the ground state of the helium atom had that particular orientation, up, down, minus, down, up, as the lowest energy state. So if I put the two electrons like this, and they're able to be in whatever state they want, and I occasionally touch them to each other, They'll try to reorganize themselves into something which has this lower energy state. And then I can take them apart, and they'll start to rotate to get into this configuration. And if I take them apart quick enough, I can control their relative rotation. And that turned out to be enough ingredients to make a universal computing machine if I can rotate the individual spins and I can control the timing that they touch each other. And that seemed like something that we could get our head around. So approximately then, we started playing with these ideas. This is the surface of an electron gas. It's something in which you constrain electrons to live in two dimensions by putting two different semiconductors in a heterostructure, and at the interface between the two semiconductors, electrons will live in form of something like a two-dimensional metal. And what I mean by strictly two dimensions, it's not just like aluminum foil, which is thin, but it's like the third dimension is in its lowest quantum state, like the hydrogen atom, and the other two dimensions are free. That's what I mean by two dimensions. So this is something which is quantum confined in that direction and free to move in the other two directions. And then you do something very easy, which is you just put metal gates on the surface. And it's not surprising that if you put a negative voltage on a gate, the electrons won't want to go underneath it because they're repelled from the negative voltage. So they just go in the dark gray areas. And you can steer them around on this thing by changing the voltages that appear on these things. So you can make a box with one electron in it. Now, it's interesting timeline. This paper, 1998, marked the challenge to make this kind of device, but it wasn't until 2000 that anybody had even made a box in which they could put one electron. It's funny that it didn't take that long for it to happen. Basically, nobody had tried. So that happened, and then it was a few years later that you could put two next to each other and do these kinds of manipulations of one spin relative to the other, like an entanglement experiment. And then you could put three, and there's an interesting reason, something that happens with three. Three gives you two axes of control, which lets you move things freely on the Bloch sphere for you quantum mechanics people. And four allows you to make two entangled qubits and start to study entanglement. And, you know, okay, so the timeline, it's not exactly Moore's law. I mean, it's a kind of an inverse Moore's law. Like if you put a logarithmic scale on the horizontal axis and a linear scale on the vertical axis, it comes out that way. So it's a kind of an inverse Moore's law. But you know, maybe this is a different problem than classical computing, and will follow its own timeline. So these chips, the ones that I showed you before, happen to be a semiconductor called gallium arsenide, and they're particularly good for growing these structures where you can change the semiconductor material without changing the crystal structure. And so this is one of those chips that sits in the middle of a board that we made. And these boards have a fair amount of electronics on it. And it looks, you know, not so different from conventional electronics. But that's one of these things. And down in the middle of all of those wire bonds are some of these quantum dot devices. That thing sits inside of a machine here. Scott referred to a dilution refrigerator. Well, that's what the inside of one of those things looks like. Now, this is a particularly challenging regime. We talk about low temperature here. These things have to get down to something like 10 millikelvin, 1/100th of a degree above absolute zero. They're commercial products now that you buy, and they have to get your chip cold. But the important thing, and really the new thing in physics research, is that there's a very difficult corner of parameter space that you have to work in. In that parameter space, we can call giga nano milli. Okay? It's millikelvin, nanometers, because the devices have to be boxes for electrons or boxes for Majoranas, as I'll talk in a second, and gigahertz, because you have to do all of the manipulations fast compared to the decoherence times. So any two of those is not so bad, but when you have to get millikelvin, nanometers, and gigahertz all going at the same time, it's a new branch of research. Interestingly, it's a branch of research in which nobody's very well trained. Most of my students have never run a network analyzer or know what a Smith chart is or done anything that really resembles electrical engineering. And most of the electrical engineers haven't studied enough quantum mechanics to be totally comfortable with what we're doing. So I would say, in fact, that this chapter calls for a revision of physics education, not only learning about quantum mechanics in the context of information, which I think is already happening in most of our schools, there are courses on quantum information, but in the training of experimentalists to learn about nano, giga, milli. And right now, there are very few in the world. So these are filters and, you know, all this kinds of high-frequency stuff that goes with this. This is what one of these things looks like when it's buttoned up in a laboratory. Here's a laboratory with several of these along, and you sort of lose all the magic inside of this gray cylinder, but inside of there is all of the working parts that we just talked about. So we've gone from this kind of abstract idea of taking something and making a Bell inequality measurement or making a separated singlet state to something where you could now imagine a chip in which you put two electrons in a box, you separate the two, and they remain spin correlated, and you do that kind of experiment. So we've done those, and I want to give you a sense that we are not on an engineering mission. Or maybe even if we were on an engineering mission, we're not being successful on an engineering mission, because every time we think that we're just trying to make something work, we end up discovering something. So let me give you an example. We take those two electrons and we put them together, and we're going to do a simple experiment in which we separate them, and we want to find out an answer to a simple question, which is, if we make this kind of entanglement experiment, we make a singlet, we separate it apart, how long have we got? You know, my kids have this candy rule that if you drop the candy on the floor for 5 seconds, you can still pick it up and eat it. It's still clean. And this is kind of the quantum version of that question, which is, if you make a singlet and you separate it spatially, how long have you got before it falls apart? And the way to ask the question is to try to put those two electrons back in the same box again, because they'll only go back in the box if they're singlets. If anything else has happened to them, it's another story. So here's what happens as a function of time in nanoseconds, how long you've got them separated. Initially, when the time is very short, they all go back in the box. They're singlets, and they stay for a long time. But if you wait only 50 nanoseconds, then they all come back as triplets. They've rotated. But then if you wait 100 nanoseconds, they all come back again. Then away and away and back and forth. And what is that? Why are they oscillating between whether they come back? It's not that the singlet is falling apart. It's that something's rotating around something else. Well, this turned out to be a long, beautiful story that I don't have time to tell you. But what were they oscillating around? They were oscillating around the effective magnetic field created by the gallium and arsenic nuclei in the system. The nuclei of those atoms have their own spins. And the spin-spin interaction, the thing which in atomic physics is called the hyperfine interaction, conspires to make the spins rotate around the spins of the crystal itself. Well, that's interesting. Now you have to start a whole new field, which is spinless semiconductors. Semiconductors made out of material that don't have nuclear spins. What are some examples? Silicon is an interesting example. You think you should have started with silicon in the first place. Silicon has its own headaches. It also has 4% silicon 29, which is complicated, but there are places where you can get isotopically pure silicon. Carbon 12 has zero nuclear spin. You could make these out of carbon nanotubes. You could maybe make them out of graphene. You could use these new kinds of materials. They have their own challenges. Crystal, was that a green 5-minute sign you were holding up for me? Okay. I would like to introduce a third weirdness. And this is one which, unless, I mean, maybe for some very smart person, they would understand how it was the same weirdness as the negative probabilities and the entanglement. But for me, it seems like a yet independent weirdness. Another chapter of quantum mechanics which is totally absent in classical physics, and it will lead us to a new kind of qubit which I'd like to spend the last 5 minutes talking about. And that is the fact that in quantum mechanics, every electron is exactly the same as every other electron. Which means that if you want to count configurations like you're doing a statistics problem and they're all thrown out on the table and you ask how many different configurations are there, and you want to know what to do when you just take the same ones and you swap them, the answer is you can't count that as an independent count, because electrons are exactly the same as each other. And that law of physics ends up showing up in what we call the statistics of the particles. For instance, if I take two particles and I swap them on the table, only one of two things can happen in three dimensions. Either, oh, look, I've labeled it wrong. I've swapped those. Sorry. Good eye. Yeah. So put that word up there. I need to do that with the labels. Okay. So if there's a minus sign that comes up, who cares what they're called? They're fermions and they pick up a minus sign. Why only a plus or minus? Because if you do it twice, they should come back to where they started. That seems only fair. doing it twice is just about the same as bringing one around the other. In fact, that's a displacement plus bringing one around the other, and so it better come back to the same. Now, that's not true in two dimensions. And you'll remember, we already figured out how to make things in two dimensions with this sandwich structure of semiconductors. In two dimensions, it's not true because the system can remember who went around who as if there was string hanging down below. And you could encode in the tangling of the string whether or not something has gone around. So in two dimensions, it's possible that just moving something around something else can create a whole new wave function. And that's the basis of a new kind of quantum information processing called topological quantum information. And it has a robustness which is not present in conventional qubits. Because, for instance, and would you stand up for just a second? Because what I can take advantage of is the fact that I can change your quantum state. Just by doing that. Never touching you. And it doesn't matter what path I use, and it doesn't matter whether the wind blows and distorts my path, and it doesn't matter whether it changes my energy. It only matters whether or not I surround you. I can change your state. Thank you. Now, there has been an explosion of research in the last few years concerning how to implement, how to make particles that aren't bosons or fermions that live in two dimensions. Just because they don't need to be bosons and fermions, it turns out that in fact, they usually are. They're usually the boring kind. But it seems that there are hidden in places these so-called non-abelian particles, particles that if you move them around each other, they'll change their quantum state. And the current recipes are not so obvious, and I won't have time to go into them, but the recipes look like things like take a one-dimensional system that has a strong coupling between the spin direction, which we've already talked about, and the direction that it's moving. So that if I have my spin up and I move this way, I have one energy. And if I move my spin that way, I have a different energy. But moving this way with my spin up is the same as moving that way with my spin down. So there is a symmetry, but it's the reverse and flip symmetry. And that, which is a common thing in materials. Why? Because in a material, as you know, there are electric fields that hold the electrons in. If I'm a moving electron, an electric field looks like a magnetic field, as we learn from relativity or even from Maxwell's equations. So that effective magnetic field orients the spin. But when I turn around the other way, the V cross E that gives me a B for Maxwell equations is the opposite direction. So I get that all the time in materials. If I couple that thing to a superconductor and turn on enough external magnetic field, I can enter a regime called the topological regime. And in that high magnetic field, strong spin orbit, superconducting regime, I can create particles, these little red dots schematically represented at the ends of this wire, which have this property, this braiding property. How do you braid them? Well, you have to take advantage of properties of quantum mechanics that allow you to move them around each other. How do you surround them, like I did with Joe? I surround them by doing something like you do when you're parking a truck. You have to do kind of a three-point turn and move things around. And you can make networks of these things. These wires are exquisitely fantastic. Here's the crystal structure inside of one of these wires. You can see the indium arsenic atoms. This is a transmission electron micrograph showing the crystal structure. And using devices similar to this, early last year, our collaborator Leo Cowenhoven and his group in Delft identified in just the regime where you'd think that it would be, in an indium antimonide, this is a slightly different material with even stronger spin orbit coupling, with a coupled superconductor, a spot in which the Majorana fermion, the end state, that red ball at the end, energyless, massless, spinless, energyless particle would live. What could be How would you detect something that was massless, energyless, spinless? The answer is it's a window, and you can go through it. So what he did was he measured how well electricity goes through the end. And that little window created by the particle produced a spot, that spot right there. Or if you like to look at it this way, that spot right there. Now, is this locked in? Are we ready to build a quantum computer? No. We've seen the particle. Okay? For my own group, a slightly more complicated arrangement here with the two superconductors at the two ends. This is all very recently published stuff from 2013. Similar kinds of behavior and similar kinds of results. Where's the field going now? Back into material science. Now we're trying to go back to the growth chamber to make materials in which the indium arsenide and the aluminum are grown so-called epitaxially. Just like I showed how you grow the semiconductor and you put the electron gas here, now we're growing superconductors inside of the same thing, coating the wires with superconductors, putting even the aluminum just on one side of the superconductors. It's a long, complicated problem, especially when you start thinking about these incredibly complicated theoretical proposals to make computing machines out of these Majorana fermions. Here are various theoretical proposals. They all involve these very complicated stories, the kind of thing that would be a little bit hard to make out of a one-dimensional wire. So where the field is now is starting to carve down into two-dimensional systems. This is from my own group, inducing superconductivity in indium antimonide, the same wires that the Delft group used, but now in a two-dimensional system that you can carve down. And here's the induced superconductivity that you can see. So this last qubit, the topological qubit, the one in which you don't need to touch the particle, in which it's immune from conventional decoherence, is both enticing, new, mathematically complicated, and really in its infancy in the lab. But I think if you have the taste for problems in which there is a great vista of unknown that seems in some way to project onto the problem of information processing, then I think this is the problem for you. Thanks.
Thank you, Charlie, for that great presentation on where the physics of quantum computing is going and the devices. We're now going to hear about an existing device and studies on that device from Matthias Troyer. So Matthias is a professor of computational physics at ETH Zurich and a consultant for our quantum computing activities here at Microsoft Research. He's a recipient of an ERC advanced grant of the European Research Council, a fellow of the American Physical Society, and a member of the Aspen Center for Physics. His research activities center on large-scale simulations of quantum systems, development of new simulation algorithms, and high-performance computing. His love for new tech gadgets has led him from superconducting to quantum devices. He has tested quantum random number generators, which he has here on the table, validated analog quantum simulators for materials, one of the scientific breakthroughs of the year 2010, according to Science Magazine, and recently explored the computational capabilities of the controversial devices built by D-Wave Systems, which he's now going to talk to us about. Let's welcome Matthias.
Okay, thank you. So we know that classical hardware sometimes has problems. What was the trick there?
Go on, this worked?
This worked? No. This was here.
No, just go out of play and back into play.
Okay, let's try that. Oh, it works, yes. So we've heard yesterday that in about 15 years, Moore's law will be over, and we have to then use quantum mechanics for computing. And we already can do that. As I mentioned, there are quantum random number generators, which cost 1,000 euros. They work. There are quantum simulators in labs that stimulate to quantum models, special ones. They cost about $2 million. And we want to have a quantum computer at some point. How do those quantum random number generators work? It's simple. We have a photon source. The photon hits a mirror. It goes both through and not through. It's in both places at once. And once we measure it, then it shows up in one, and where it shows up is random, and that gives me a true random number if I believe in quantum mechanics. So this is simple and easy, and it doesn't cost too much. You can buy it in Switzerland. Now, when will we have a quantum computer like Leo Charlie talked about. And the answer is, 2 years ago, we already saw the ads, yes, you can have one. Now, you're not dreaming. D-Wave offers the first commercial quantum computing system on the market, and they sold one to Lockheed Martin for $10 million. Now, some people have heard of that company, others didn't, so let's look at the webpage. We have a problem with impossible. And are you ready for this? They want to apply the unique quantum computing technology to basically solve your problems. Now, that's what they say. Let's go to a serious source, New York Times. In March, on the front page of the business section, they show the device. It looks just like Charlie's device. It's just a cryostat. And there's something hidden down there, and that's this device. A strange computer promises great speed. What do they write on page one? If it performs as Lockheed and D-Wave expect, the design could be used to basically solve problems millions of times faster than anything classical. But the New York Times is a serious newspaper, and so we turn the leaf over and look at the bottom of page two. They write the disclaimer. However, scientists have not yet published data showing that it is actually faster. And critics like Scott say that it's basically a classical device and not quantum at all. So what's going on? We just have to wait, and it gets better. In May, there's a statement in the press, and this device is 3,600 times faster than the fastest classical computer. One blog even mentioned it's worth about 20 petaflop performance, so that's the best thing around. What was that based on? There was a paper at the ACM conference where they compared the time to solution on that device on a special purpose heuristic device against a general purpose exact solver. And in that comparison, the device was 3,600 times faster. But the authors also write in the paper, which was not picked up by the press, that it would, of course, be interesting to see if a highly tuned classical implementation could compete. And we've tried that. So some journalists don't just read the press releases, but they call up Scott. Scott tells them to talk to me, or tells them what I told him. And then they realize there's something weird in quantum mechanics, and it's faster, slower, or both at once. Maybe it's a quantum superposition of being fast and slower. But in the end, maybe that's the wrong question to ask. We're in the academia, but maybe the right answer is just whether you can just sell it. And soon later, they sold the next device to NASA and Google, and maybe that's all they need to do. They just sell and make money, and who cares whether it's quantum or not? But we want to know what's behind this. What does this thing really do? And because they sold the device to Lockheed Martin, and Lockheed Martin also wants to know what's inside this black box here, they let us access it. And so we know already it is not a universal quantum computer. It's only a special purpose device. It's not what Scott and Charlie talked about, but it's a very special purpose device. It raises some questions that we can answer. Does it work or not? Does it even solve the problem it's supposed to solve? If it works, then the question is it quantum or classical? And even if it's quantum, the question is it really thousands of times faster than anything we have classically? If it's not yet, might it be fast in the future? And we then set out and say, we have to kind of look at this black box and see what it does. And that was the plan. So what is it supposed to do? It is a machine designed to solve a binary quadratic optimization problem. You have some variables, the qubits, they can be 0 or 1, and you want to minimize this quadratic cost function. And finding that solution is exponentially hard, although we can prove it, as you said, Scott. Right? So as a physicist, I don't like 0, 1, I like minus 1 and plus 1, and that's what I call an Ising spin glass, but it's the same thing. So I want to solve this quadratic problem. I want to find the minimum. Now, this is interesting because it's an NP-hard problem. And so if I can solve that efficiently and fast, then I can solve many NP complete your problems, and that would be very interesting and fascinating. And the open question is, can a quantum device solve these problems faster than a classical one? At all? We don't know that yet. If it can, then can that D-Wave device do it? So what is it doing? How does it work? How does it find it? It uses quantum annealing. Now, annealing is a very old technology. It is 7,000 years old. The first evidence was seen on the copper vessel from Stone Age Turkey. It's ancient. What you basically do, you take a metal or a glass, you heat it up, you cool it down slowly, and it goes into a better state. By slow cooling, it comes closer to the ground state. In simulated annealing, we want to use that to simulate a model. We slowly cool it, and we hope that by slowly cooling, this ball here finds the global minimum. And we do that in a Monte Carlo simulation of the system. That's very simple, but very powerful optimization method. Of course, sometimes it's hard. Let's make a very narrow and deep funnel. Sometimes we're lucky it falls in. Sometimes we try it, and it finds the wrong local minimum, so we try it many times, and then we hope that we find the true minimum. Now, quantum annealing might be better. How much better, we don't know yet, but it's better because in quantum mechanics, we don't know where the particle is. It can be anywhere. We're not even allowed to ask the question. So it starts out basically being everywhere. So let me start from a totally flat landscape, a flat box, and the particle can be anywhere. The wave function is just constant. There's a constant probability of finding it somewhere when I look. But now before I look, I switch on my landscape, and I run it, and this wave function that was spread out then suddenly concentrates around the minimum region. When I then look, then I find it most likely at the deepest point. Now let's look at the harder problem. Let's take a deep funnel, and when I do it too fast, then it's still stuck on the wrong side. So for hard problems, I have to run slowly, and when I run this slowly enough, then you see, at first it thinks this will become the minimum because it's nice and big and broad, but then at some time it starts to tunnel over, and then it finds the true point. When I then look now, it will be in here. So it's not magic, but for hard problems, I might have to run it very slowly. And the question is, do I need to run it exponentially slowly or not? Will it give me any advantage over a classical algorithm? It might, but we don't know. So how does the D-Wave device solve the problem, and what do they do? They use a so-called superconducting qubit. They start with a superconducting ring, and in there they can have a current flowing clockwise or counterclockwise. If it flows counterclockwise, that current induces a field that points up, a flux that points up. If it flows clockwise, it induces a flux that points down. And those two are the states of the qubit. And it can flip from one to the other. So these are the states, and then they build up a device from here. How do they do the couplings? The coupling is just the magnetic coupling between those fluxes, and that they can program and tune. That sounds easy. The device they build then has 40,000 junctions in there. It is a very complex device. It took them 10 years to build. This is really well built. But even they didn't know whether it works as they think it should. So the first one they sold to Lockheed Martin had 108 qubits working out of the 128. The next one that they sold in March and installed at the USC had 503 qubits working out of 512. That's what it looks like, the chip. There are all those qubits lined up here. And that realizes this graph here, where the lines are the edges of the graph where they can program the couplings. And on those edges, they can set the couplings, and so they couple to at most 6 neighbors. It's a special sparse graph they built. And on this graph, they do quantum annealing, they say. So the question now is it really a quantum device? Or is it classical? We don't know whether it's a quantum device because those qubits are not perfect. They are imperfect. They stay quantum for a few nanoseconds only. We anneal for milliseconds sometimes. So we just don't know whether it's quantum. Then that's at the finite temperature and not at the ground state, so we just don't know. But we can now make tests on the machine to test our hypothesis. First, we all thought it's just a classical device. In this case, it should work like our classical annealer. Or we could think it's a quantum annealer, then it should work like a simulated quantum annealer. Or the third hypothesis, it's actually a quantum annealer that in addition is faster than a classical device, then it should show quantum speed up. For the first hypothesis, the test is then it should just look like a classical Monte Carlo simulation. For the second test, it should look like a simulation of a quantum model. And for the third, it should just be better than any simulation I can come up with. So what did we do? We didn't want to fold a protein, as some people did, but we want to find really hard problems. And we looked for the hardest problem I can do on that graph, and for that I picked the couplings to be either plus or minus one randomly, just some hard random problem. And for those problems, so I pick 1,000 of those problems. Each of those 1,000 problems I'm running 1,000 times to hope to at least once find the true ground state. I'm running that on the 10 problem sizes for 10 different schedules of the annealing, which gives me about 100 million runs on the device and which gives me a few billion simulations, most of which were performed by Dave Wecker here at MSR. Now we want to look what do we find. And how do we compare? I have a terabyte of data, and we want to find out, is it quantum or not? The simplest test we found is we just look how often does it find the true solution, and we make a histogram. This is the histogram for the classical annealer. We have some problems where the success probability is close to 1. Almost every time I find the solution. Some problems are harder, it's only about half the time, and some problems are very hard, it's very rarely that I find it. I find just one peak. When I change the schedule, that peak moves a bit. When I do the quantum Monte Carlo simulation, I see 2 peaks. Some instances are very easy, some are very hard. On the device, I see the same. Some are very easy, some are very hard. It does not look like my classical annealer, so let me drop that. So from this, I conclude it's not just this simple classical annealer. But of course, it doesn't tell me yet that it's really the same as my quantum Monte Carlo simulation. To check for that, what we're next doing is we're looking at correlations. So for those 1,000 problems we ran, I make a scatter plot. And I plot here what is the probability of finding the ground state in one run on the device. And here on the device, and here in my quantum Monte Carlo code. And I find that all of the problems most of the problems that are easy are easy on both, are easy in my simulation of a quantum system and easy on the device. Those which are hard in my simulation of the quantum system are also hard on the device. So there's a very good correlation of the hardness on the device with the hardness of my quantum simulation on the classical machine. And we understand what makes those problems hard, and it's a property of the quantum model. So it's the same problem here. These are hard for both the simulation of the quantum model and the device. And these here are easy for both the simulation and the device. And so I conclude from that that this state is consistent with that device actually doing quantum annealing, because it's the same instances that are hard or easy. So now from this, I believe them that they really have built a quantum device. This is a quantum annealer. Now the other question is it useful? So to look at that, I'm looking at the time to find the solution. And for the time here, I now do not count the time needed to program it, to cool it, because those might be improved. This is just the intrinsic time I need to anneal, the intrinsic time to find the solution. And on the first device, it could never be faster than 5 microseconds. This was the shortest time they could run it. And here I show the median time over those 1,000 instances. And for a small problem, I just run it once and basically always find it. For the harder problem, I have to run it 2 or 3 times, and the time goes up to 15 microseconds. Now you might be optimistic and say, OK, it goes up, and it grows maybe linearly for an NP-complete problem. Now I can compare that to a classical exact solver. And that has something startup time, but then it starts growing exponentially. And so I'm always about 1,000 times faster than the exact classical solver. So that part is true. This machine is really much faster than an exact classical algorithm, but it's just heuristic. Now let us compare it against my Monte Carlo simulation. First, the Monte Carlo simulation of the quantum model, the simulated quantum annealer. This scales exponentially and is about 1,000 times slower. Now I'm showing a classical Monte Carlo simulation. This is a much easier code, and this is the code that the student would just write as the homework if he's a good student uses the compiled programming language. And the scaling is exponential, as we expect for an NP complete problem, and it's slower than the DWF device for the big problems. But then I can optimize my code. Now I optimize it by using every single bit of an integer as a spin. And when I update 64 spins at the same time in one operation. That makes the code faster by about the factor of 10. Then I make it parallel on the 8 cores of a CPU, or I use a GPU, and the time goes down and down and down and down. And for the 108 device, we can then be about 15 times faster if we use the fastest classical chip that we have. But the question is, of course, the scaling. How does this scale? And D-Wave has to be optimistic. Their device will scale nicely, and it will cross over. So this March, we got access to the 512 qubit device, and we could extend the scaling up to 512. In April, the lawyers let us actually get access to it. And this is the curve. It starts to bend up. When you look at this, then it starts to become essentially parallel to it. You might still be optimistic and say, hey, it's not really the same slope yet. But then you have to take into account that that device, as it increases the problem size, it's analog. I'm adding more and more hardware to it. If I use more and more hardware as I increase the problem size, you should also allow that to me classically. And if you do that, then from 200 up to 500, the two lines are perfectly parallel. We don't see any speed up here. So, but this is for one specific benchmark, for one specific test. We tried 6 other tests, they all looked worse. But D-Wave and Google are looking for problems where they might see some speed up. So to summarize here, this is a special purpose device that using quantum mechanics finds the solution, finds the global optimum out of 2 to the 503 states. This is highly non-trivial. It works. This is good engineering, but I can match it with one high-end CPU. So will it ever be useful? What are the challenges that we need to overcome it? We need to go to bigger problems for it to be useful. But even then, I've used the problems that this machine was built for, the one that ideally mapped to their sparse graph. If you want to map a general problem, then if you want to map an n-variable problem, you need n squared qubits. So there's a big overhead. Next problem is calibration. That's an analog device with about 5% calibration error. Most applications need much smaller errors. So the best bet to solve these two problems is I need Charlie to build us a beautiful digital gate-based quantum computer, and then we simulate D-Wave on this perfect computer, and that might be better. So that's my bet. Thank you.
So unfortunately, we ran a little bit into our break. Hopefully, you were already in superposition of break and talk, so you feel you had some break already. But let's thank again all three of our speakers. I hope that today in this session you've learned a little bit more about the challenges we're facing in quantum computing and the quantum devices and quantum physics, and that you've learned something about the recent progress in the devices, the algorithms, and also the studies of existing devices. So again, let's thank the three speakers, and I hope you can ask them questions during the break and later today. But thank you, Scott, Matthias, and Charlie, for these wonderful talks.